That was very informative. All right, we are now going to hear from Dr. Gordon Thompson, who's a research professor at Clark University and the executive director of the Institute for Resource and Security Studies up in Cambridge.
Thank you. Good morning. I have this slide. Thank you. My presentation is supported by three declarations that I've asked to be distributed to the commissioners that were produced on behalf of a consortium of environmental groups around the United States. But this presentation is strictly my own views. Next slide, please. This slide shows a low-density rack. The NRC staff appears to have forgotten what a low-density rack looks like. These used to be standard. In my view, it's a reason what a low-density rack looks like. These used to be standard. In my view, it's a reasonably respectable piece of nuclear engineering, passively safe against water loss under most circumstances. Next slide, please. I don't expect you to read all the detail of this slide on the screen, but the point is that the staff has looked at only a small fraction of the possible scenarios that could lead to loss of water in the event of an accident or an attack. And I'll return to probabilities of these events later. So there's a large number of scenarios that are just not addressed at all in staff analysis to date. Next slide, please. This slide shows a situation of partial loss of water from a spent fuel pool, which I describe as the severe reference case. This represents many possible scenarios for loss of water, and for three decades plus, the NRC has refused to systematically study this case. Even though there has been a partial precedent in the PAX II accident in Hungary in 2003. Next slide, please. This slide shows what I describe as ignition delay time, which is the shortest time required for spent fuel to heat up to the point of zircaloy ignition. This shows that we're dealing with a relatively slow developing incident for fuel aged 1,000 days, a little over 3 years. We're looking at 21 hours in the fastest case for heat up. So you might think if the accident is so, the incident is so slow developing, why should we worry about it? Next slide, please. This gives a hint as to why we might worry about it a great deal. This illustrative case shows the on-site contamination due to a reactor release. It's a simplified illustrative case, but in this instant, average over the first day, a lethal dose would be accrued in 4 minutes of exposure, and over the first 7 days, within 10 minutes of exposure, suggesting that in this instant and others like it, mitigating actions would be precluded if they involved any human action on site. Next slide, please. Outcomes, why are we worried? We've had two large actual releases. The Chernobyl case, Mikhail Gorbachev retrospectively concluded that this release was perhaps the dominant cause of the collapse of the Soviet Union. And one could extend that to the Warsaw Pact. So dramatic political and social effects. In Fukushima, where we have a fallout of only 6 petabecquerels, there are to this day 160,000 people reportedly displaced, and the entire nuclear fleet is shut down. Looking at potential releases, the NRC has looked at a peach bottom release of 330 petabecquerels, leading to long-term displacement of 4.1 million people, which I'd submit would be a national disaster. The French agency IRSN has attempted to add up all the economic damage from a hypothetical release of 100 petabecquerels at the Dampierre facility, and their high case is $8 trillion, which is about half the current U.S. gross domestic product. Next slide, please. Inventory is available for release. Each pool at Peach Bottom, 2,200 petabecquerels, twice what's in the Fukushima Unit 4 pool, and a great deal more than the 6 petabecquerels fall out from Japan. Circumstances at Peach Bottom could lead to a release in the range of 2,000 petabecquerels, vastly greater than what we experienced at Chernobyl or Fukushima. Next slide, please. Brings us to some broad questions about risk. Common to say that risk is the product of probability and consequences. Although that's common, it's important to be clear that this is not a scientific statement. It's a statement of ideology. It's a statement of value and has no scientific basis. What should be the indicator of probability? Given the scale of consequences of a very large release of cesium, I believe an appropriate indicator would be the number of occurrences per century across all nuclear facilities in the United States. The probability and consequences could be determined in large or dominant part by qualitative factors. And that's particularly true of potential attacks. And having a large amount of cesium positioned where it can be released by attack, I submit actually attracts attack and increases the probability. It's, I think, legitimate to describe spent fuel pools adjacent to operating reactors as pre-emplaced radiological weapons awaiting activation by an enemy of the United States. Final observation is that the staff has, for more than three decades, focused on rapid and total loss of water from spent fuel pools. This is a reprise of a focus in the 1960s on large break loss of coolant accidents from reactors. And this, in my view, fundamentally warped the design of reactors in terms of containments and safety systems. Next slide, please. Fukushima incident, some people take as a sign of reassurance. I take it as a wake-up call. Next slide, please. Now, reverting to low-density open-frame racks, and I'm talking about true low-density open-frame racks, not the low-density case considered by the NRC staff. The cost driver is predominantly the transfer cost, the transfer fuel from high-density racks to dry casks. Now, this transfer is going to occur anyway when the reactors are shut down. In the absence of a repository or a centralized store. Thus, the incremental cost of acting now is simply the time value of the transfer cost. The preceding speaker from EPRI quoted around $3.5 billion. I submit that the true cost is substantially less than that. It's whatever the time value is of that cost. There is an issue of high burn-up fuel, which complicates the transfer to dry casks. That's symptomatic of a larger problem with high burn-up fuel that I believe requires attention. Final slide, please, conclusions. Given the information available, I believe that the commissioners should order the rapid reversion of all pools in the United States to low-density open-frame racks. That would require excess spent fuel to be transferred to dry storage. The commissioners should also require the staff to scrap its pool fire consequence study and its Tier 3 analysis and send them back to do a really thorough, open, and science-based inquiry into the phenomena related to pool fires, including risk linkages between pools and reactors. And in the declarations that I've submitted and that I mentioned earlier, I have laid out in some detail what those investigations should cover. And at the same time, the issue of cask fires should be addressed. And I can explain what I mean by that if necessary. And this inquiry should be internationalized because pool hazards exist elsewhere. Le Hague in France is a good example where there are four pools positioned so that the mid-height of the fuel is about at grade level, and they're licensed to hold almost 18,000 tons of spent fuel. It's, I think, the largest spent fuel hazard I'm aware of. Hence, an international inquiry would be appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you, Gordon.